Do you want me to leave this up while you're speaking? Or...
Wow, this is really impressive.
There's still quite a few people who are showing up a little late.
That's all right.
I'm going to give a few opening remarks, and then Slog is going to come up and introduce you.
Okay.
So I'm giving an introduction to the introduction.
Okay, very good.
Eddie, how do I fix this?
Oh. There's a mouse and keyboard down there.
The reserve spots are for you guys. Hey guys, is everyone here? Is everyone in? We'll start. Okay.
Hi everyone. Hi. Hi, my name is Prisa Fala. I'm a first-year medical student here at Harvard. I'm also the national chair of the Global Surgery Student Alliance. So on behalf of the GSSA team, I would like to welcome all of you to the Boston Global Surgery Symposium, which was made possible by the GSSA chapters here at Harvard and BU Med, as well as the Student Surgery Society at the Harvard Chan School of Public Health. We are joined by 200 students from medical schools at Harvard, BU, Tufts, UMass, Dartmouth, Yale, Brown, and Penn State. And on top of that, residents and trainees from hospitals in the area, as well as undergraduates. We are also kindly joined by members of the Clutchigan Foundation, the Program for Global Surgery and Social Change, the Center for Surgery and Public Health, and Lifebox. I'd also love to welcome our live streaming audience, including hundreds of students from over 40 schools around the US and Canada, and from quite a few other countries as well. We are joined by friends from Germany, England, Belgium, South Africa, Morocco, and more. So before we start, I just wanted to share a few words about who we are. The Global Surgery Student Alliance is the national student-run global surgery working group for the US, affiliated with the International Student Surgical Network. We believe that students are a valuable resource for the advancement of global surgery. We also believe that being unified in our efforts will help further our initiatives and can also facilitate more collaboration amongst overall global surgery efforts, both now and in the future. By exposing students to the field early on, we also hope to help them build their surgical careers with global surgery in mind. Ultimately, Many students are willing and able to make significant contributions to global surgery, and we hope to be a resource that facilitates those efforts. This symposium is a testament to the power of youth to advance the field. It was 15 medical students and residents who put all of this together in less than 4 months. Our hope is that the amazing speakers here today will inspire you all with their experiences and encourage you to consider global surgery as you go into your careers. As students, we have an incredible opportunity to contribute to global surgery in very unique ways, and it is important for us to take on that role to help advance the field. Now, it is with sincere joy and gratitude that I introduce SWOG, who is a friend and colleague, as well as an incredible surgery resident and global surgery fellow who has contributed so much to the field. He will be introducing our keynote, Dr. John Mira. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. This is quite a crowd, and when Parissa started talking about this just a few months ago, I would not have expected all of this, but this is really amazing. My name's Swag. I'm one of the fellows in the program of Global Surgery and Social Change that Dr. Mira was one of the founders and is the director for, and I have the privilege of introducing him. As many of you know, he's the Clutchin Professor for Global Surgery at Harvard Medical School and the chair of the Department of Plastics and Oral Surgery at Boston Children's Hospital. But really, I know Dr. Mira as the man that does everything. And to introduce him, I'd like to share very quickly my favorite memory, or one of my favorite memories from my time at the PGSSC. So as many of you might know, it wasn't until very recently that there were indicators for surgery as a component of health. You know, there have been indicators for many other things, but not for surgery and anesthesia in the surgical system. And it wasn't until a couple of years ago, after a lot of effort and work from our group and many other groups, that we happened to be at the World Bank in DC. It was Dr. Mira, Dr. Mark Schreim, our research director, and myself. And we were going to sit down with representatives from the World Bank to discuss, you know, this handful of indicators that we had come up with and discuss their utility and why they should be collected on a global scale and the impact that they would have for people. And as we're sitting there waiting for this meeting, and you know, this is a setting where Margaret Chan of the WHO is like walking around in the background and we're sitting there drinking coffee. The time before this meeting, we weren't sitting there prepping slides. We weren't sitting there discussing, you know, talking points or going through any bulleted lists. What we were doing is we were on Skype with Dr. Mira's daughter, struggling, absolutely struggling to help her with her calculus homework. Really, to me, you know, so much of academic global surgery versus clinical global surgery have such different focuses, and you know, there's so much about data and so much about, you know, p-values, et cetera. And I think that moment really spoke to me about creating time and prioritizing things that are important. And it's amazing to see so many people who prioritize global surgery in general, which is a big reason why I'm part of this program and why I know Dr. Mira. So really that, like I said, that's one of my favorite memories of the program, and is a brief glimpse of the interaction that we have with Dr. Mira, and what, you know, from helping with homework to developing indicators to developing national surgical plans. It's kind of the gamut of the things that we do at PGSSC, and what I'm sure all of you are involved with as well. Hopefully not too much homework, though. But with that, you know, I'd like to have Dr. Mira come up here, the man who can create time by defying physics and does everything.
Thank you. That's amazing. Can everyone hear me? Is this okay? All right, so I had forgotten all about that, and actually, so you called me out. The reason that we have the fellowship is so these guys can help my kids with their calculus homework, because I've long forgotten it. This is amazingly impressive. I have to be honest, when SWOG told me about this a couple months ago, I honestly I thought it was going to be me, SWOG, and five or six med students having a little conference. And what you guys have accomplished in a few months is just spectacular. I've never seen anything like it so quickly. So don't underestimate, A, what you've done, and B, what you could do in the future. I mean, you guys are just a force of nature, and you are the future. So, you know, you are going to take the baton from SWOG and I in the future. So I'm glad you're here. With that, what I want to talk to you about today is the Lancet Commission. And I'm going to tell you the story of kind of how this started, the process we went through, and then at the end I have a number of slides that will tell you a little bit about the implication and what has happened since the publication. So first I want a little bit of ancient history, because I need to set the stage for you. You know, years ago, the public health community really didn't think about surgery. You know, it wasn't thought to be cost effective, it was too expensive, you know, you had to get... It was, how could you possibly get plastic surgeons and orthopedic surgeons and neurosurgeons? You know, Key and George Dyer are here. You can't, that's too complicated. You can't do that. So immunizations seemed much more cost effective. So we were really not part of the public health dialogue at all. All right, and so now I want to go back actually really far to 6 BC. Now, does everyone knows what BC means, right? Okay, all right, so I don't need this slide at all then. And it kind of gives you a perspective, like, for my life, I'm only half joking when I tell you my life is like before commission and after commission, because it was such a monumental part of my career. So in 6 BC, so 6 years before the commission, this is Paul Farmer at the Rwanda Surgical Society. Robert was there as well. And the reason I bring this up is it just seems so unusual that, can you hear me?
The mic is a little bit.
Mic is not working? All right, let's try.
Sorry about that.
All right. How's that? Can you guys hear me better? Better? All right. So, 6 years before the commission, Paul Farmer was at the Rwanda Surgical Society. And if you think about that just for a minute, it's kind of unusual that the world's expert in infectious disease, why would he be at the Rwanda Surgical Society? Why would he care? And I asked him once, I said, you know, why are you so interested in surgery? And he said, look, it doesn't make any sense for us to spend, you know, thousands of dollars on antiretrovirals if the patient the next day dies of a perforated appendix. You know, so that's why I'm concerned about that. So again, 6 years before the commission, he and Jim Kim wrote this article, which, you know, this tagline has become really famous, and we almost can't go to a global surgery meeting without somebody talking about the neglected stepchild of global health. But his point was what I was just explaining to you, that surgery was not really part of the, you know, public health discourse. And so that had been our objective. All right, so that's just a little backdrop of what was leading up to the Lancet Commission and why, you know, why this was important. So just a little bit of backstory to the commissions themselves. So this is something that started maybe 10 or 12 years ago. Richard Horton started this at the Lancet, and it's turned out to be a very forward-thinking mechanism for the Lancet, in the sense that they commission groups to come together around something of importance in global health, maybe once a year or so. And Richard Horton feels very, you know, very strongly that this is to inform and drive policy change. So these are not just meant to be reviews of the literature. All right, he wants these to generate broad and sustainable improvement in global health. All right, and in fact, when he met with us, this is Richard Horton here, when he met with us, he sat down with our group, and he said, all right, here are your instructions. One, your commission document has to give kind of the status quo, what's going on in global surgery right now. Two, I want some key messages, and they need to be just a few. You can't give the world 47, you know, key messages, all right? And the same with recommendations. It's nice to have some recommendations, but you can't have 106 of them. And then this is something that was a little different than some commissions. He said, I want indicators or metrics. And that was very insightful, because what he knew is that there was no data on surgery. You know, you could go to a number of different sites and you could find data on all sorts of things, but there was nothing about surgery or anesthesia. And again, he reiterated this. And he told us several times, this is not meant to be just a review of the literature. It shouldn't just, you know, sit on the bookshelf of the med school when you're finished with it. It has to be an active, live document. So when we met January of 2014, so about 3 years ago, the group met actually just across the street. And one of the things that we did, which turned out to be very helpful and very smart, was we came up with a vision, first of all. Universal access to safe, affordable surgical and anesthesia care when needed. And the reason that was important is, you know, throughout the process of the Lancet Commission, we would invariably get into discussions and debates. And a couple times we had to say, hey, hold on a minute. Are we working towards universal access to safe, affordable surgical and anesthesia care when needed? So this was kind of our true north, and it really helps. It helps with any organization, and it really helped with this commission. So to quickly just give you an idea what this commission was, we met three times for what I would call our normal commission meetings. So in Boston in January, in Sierra Leone in June, actually just before Ebola really took off, and then in November in Dubai. And then we had an extra meeting in Bellagio. So the Rockefeller Foundation was kind enough to fund a meeting in Bellagio. And this was very different. We actually called a whole new group of commissioners in. And the reason we did that is we had roughed out the document by this point. And we wanted to bring it to a new group of people from NIH and USAID and Ministries of Health and give them the document and say, what does this look like to you? You know, we've roughed it out to the best of our ability. If you have to take this to your Minister of Health or Minister of Finance, what is he or she going to say about that? And so this was a very helpful meeting, and it really fine-tuned and actually brought about a couple changes that I'll tell you about later in the document. And the other thing that we did maybe a little bit more or differently than some commissions is we had a lot of regional meetings because we did not want to fall into the trap of having 30 academics, you know, come down from the mountain with two tablets and say, okay, guys, this is you know, the way it's going to be. So we wanted a lot of people to be involved in this, all right? It started with three institutions, so Lund, Lars Hagander, and me and Andy Leather from King's. But the thing that I really like about this process as it unfolded is that we ended up with collaborators in over 110 countries and universities. So a lot of people were involved, and that was important to its success because there was a lot of buy-in. And over 100 publications and abstracts and teaching cases. And this is something we did purposefully. The reason is, if you think about it, if you have one commission report, you know, how many people can be on that report? You can't have, you know, 400 authors on one document. So what we did is we went to a number of journal editors and said, hey, if we have collaborators that are working on projects, can they publish things through your journal? And many of these editors were not even the same editor as The Lancet, and that's why I give them a lot of credit. Can we publish some of our data through your journals? Put a little asterisk that says, you know, this is part of the Lancet Commission. And they did that, and what ended up happening is hundreds, you know, over 100 publications and things ended up feeding right up into the commission. All right, so you know, there were things in the World Journal of Surgery that fed into the Lancet Commission. All right, and I think they're actually different publishers, but they were nice enough to accept that and help us. So that turned out to be really powerful because getting the buy-in from so many people ended up making the process more sustainable. So I have to also give a lot of credit to Jim Kim. I would assume he's a fairly busy guy, given his title. And for him to take time out, I'm going to show you a video that he made specifically for us. And this is, he did actually two, which is amazing. So he did one in January for that initial meeting. This is a second video address that he gave to our group in May of 2015, actually, again, across the street. And I'm going to play this for you because it gives a nice overview of the key messages from the commission. And then I'll talk a little bit more about those in just a moment.
Thanks so much, John. Greetings to everyone, and sorry that I can't be with you in person. Congratulations especially to The Lancet on the release of Global Surgery 2030. Today, an astonishing 5 billion people cannot get safe, affordable surgical and anesthesia care. 90% of people in low and lower middle income countries can't even get basic surgical care. The Lancet's report shows us how we can close this gap. Its proposed time-bound indicators, for instance, are critical. They can motivate governments to provide the universal and affordable surgical and anesthesia care that people deserve. The stakes are extremely high because failing to fix this problem will have a substantial impact on people's lives, well-being, and even on their economic health going forward. 33 million people face catastrophic health expenditures due to payment for surgery and anesthesia care each year, and an additional 48 million cases of catastrophic expenditures are attributable to the non-medical costs of accessing surgical care. That's 81 million people that are plunged into poverty every year. There's also evidence that low and middle-income countries will suffer enormous losses in economic productivity over the next 15 years if this access gap persists. For these reasons, the Lancet report's findings make an important contribution to global public health. They're also an essential step to people living healthier, happier, and longer lives. It shows that we have to think in a fundamentally different way about healthcare and surgery's role in it in developing countries. Not only is access to surgery the right thing to do morally, it's also important to ending extreme poverty and boosting shared prosperity. I want to thank my good friend John Mira for his leadership on this effort, and thank everyone at The Lancet for doing such good and important work for the poorest people on the planet.
So when you think about what he just said and put that into the context of what I told you at the beginning in terms of how surgery was really not part of the public health discourse, again, I really have to give a lot of credit to the World Bank and to Jim for changing that very rapidly. All right, for the World Bank to come out with a video like that is really surprising. So what I want to do now is, he did a really exceptional job of covering those key messages very quickly, and I want to just unwrap them a little bit so you know where they came from. So the first key message that came out, which has turned out to be fairly impactful, is that 5 billion people don't have access to surgery. And what I mean by that is they don't have the same kind of access that you and I have. If I, leaving today, if I fall and break my ankle, I will be at the Brigham in about 47 seconds and I'll get taken care of, all right? That's not the case for many people in the world. Now, some of you may remember a number of 2 billion, and Atul Gawande and his group years ago came out with a number 2 billion, and they were looking at the number of pulse oxes that were in operating rooms and saying, is this a safe environment? So how many people have access to what they were considering a safe environment for surgery? And our group, and I have to tell you, Paul Farmer really pushed on this. He did not like that 2 billion number, and he was actually part of the driving force behind us coming up with this key message. He said, look, I've been all over the world. There's no possible way that actually 5 billion people do have great access to surgery, all right? He said, that's just not possible. So we started looking into it, and we said, well, let's look at our vision, universal access to safe, affordable, surgical anesthesia care when needed. There are a number of components, and that certainly isn't the entire list, but it's a partial list. So what percentage of the people in the world can get timely surgery, first of all? You know, so if you're 18 hours by donkey from a surgical facility, you know, that's not adequate surgical access, all right? So this is what's called a conditional probability analysis, which I can say those words, but I can't tell you much more about what that is. But there were people in our group that can. So, you know, you have to jump through hoops metaphorically. So A, you have to be able to get there in time. B, you get to this facility, and does it have the capacity to do what's needed? All right, does it have electricity? Does it have water, et cetera, et cetera? So let's say you jump through both of those hoops. Okay, is it safe? And so this was Atul Gawande said, you know, how many ORs have pulse oxes? And that's kind of a crude proxy. So let's say you can jump through all three of those. You can get there in a couple hours. It has electricity and water. It has an orthopedic surgeon. And it has a pulse ox. The huge problem is that most people can't afford surgery. You know, even when supposedly in some countries, you know, it's public health or it's free service, you know, they show up and you don't have to pay to actually sit in the hospital, but you have to go buy your own sutures, and you know, there are a lot of expenses or just the cost of getting there, you know, days away from work and whatnot. So, you know, when you think about patients having to jump through these four metaphorical hoops, that's where that 5 billion comes from. This is a heat map, and the darker red the color, the closer in those countries are they to 100% of the population that doesn't really have the same kind of access that you and I have. So at one of those hoops, they can't navigate through the center of that, all right? Now, we looked at another component of access to surgery, and that's your workforce. So this will take a minute to explain. So this is what we called
SAO provider density, surgical anesthesia obstetrician providers per 100,000 people. And this is numbers per 100,000 people. So this would be 10 per 100,000 of any mix. So put them all together, SAO is 10 per 100,000. And this, what we did is we pulled the World Bank outcomes data, and we looked at maternal mortality and under five mortality, et cetera, et cetera. And these curves looked pretty much the same. And so you notice that over 40, not much changes, all right? And I always say when I show this that you can't prove causality. So I'm not saying that, you know, that this proves that, you know, having 40 is much better than 20. Because, you know, a lot of you are thinking, well, there are a lot of other things that are going on in societies that have these many folks that is different from those folks. And I understand that. But we wanted to get a picture. You know, Richard Horton said, I want to know what the status quo is. And we just wanted to know what the world looked like, all right? So clearly, you know, below 20 SAOs, something's going on that is not great, all right? And it probably has a little bit to do with this. And so if we were going to tell the world something about targets, it probably ought to be greater than 20. And then again, unclear, I don't think we can raise our hand and say that countries need a whole lot more than 40. I mean, the US obviously is actually off the chart. It's over here somewhere. So, and our outcomes aren't necessarily better than some of these countries that have 50 or 60, all right? So it's just one piece of the puzzle. The other thing that the key message that we talked about is how many more procedures would be needed. So in the world, we do about 330 million procedures a year. And we estimated that to meet some kind of basic needs for people, we need 143 million more. All right, that's a spectacular number more. And the reason is that the poorest third of the world only gets 6% of the procedures in the world. All right, so huge disparity. All right, huge disparity in what's going on. And so we drilled down on that a little bit in the same way we did the SAO thing. And we said, how many procedures are occurring per 100,000 population? And again, this takes a little bit of an explanation. So this would be 5,000 surgical procedures per 100,000 population, all right? And again, you notice below about 5,000, the wheels start to fall off, all right? Things are not great down here, all right? And again, hard to argue that countries need a whole lot more than 5,000. The US actually is over here. We do about 28,000 procedures per 100,000 people, all right? And you notice, and this is true of life expectancy, maternal mortality, anything you look at, the US is not necessarily the best. We have the most healthcare providers, but we don't necessarily produce the best care, all right? So again, hard to argue that it's super wise to have, you know, a couple hundred procedures per 100,000, but no population needs to probably do 28,000 per 100,000, all right? The other thing that went into access, and just if you do look at the Lancet Commission, this will make more sense to you now. We borrowed something from the maternal health literature, something called the three delays. So patients have delays in treatment, and in their term, the first delay, second delay, third delay. Now, the first delay is delay in seeking care. And you'll see in our Lancet Commission, we grouped things around the first delay. So why do patients not seek care? And there are a whole host of reasons why they don't seek care. And we came up with some, you know, possible solutions and recommendations. Second delay, why is there a delay in reaching care? Why can they not get there? All right. And as I said before, is it 18 hours away by you know, donkey? Third delay in receiving care. So they can show up at the facility and the delay can start there. They can get to the front door, but there are a whole host of reasons why they can't actually get their surgical procedure. And this was just a helpful way for us in the Lancet Commission to segregate, you know, where are the issues, and you know, solutions will be very different for first delay than third delay, all right? And the thing that came out of this type of analysis is we went to the WHO and we got some facility level data and we said, what is a proxy for an operating room that looks like a normal operating room, that does the kinds of things that you would want it to do? And so we looked at that WHO data and we found that district hospitals that could do these types of procedures, these three types of procedures, and we ended up calling them the bellwether procedures, these operating rooms, you know, looked more like real hospitals. They could do a broader range of procedures, All right? And the reason that's helpful is, you know, I've had people from ministries of health come before the Lancet Commission and after and say, well, John, I need to know what to do in my district hospital. I mean, you can't be nebulous. Like, I have these district hospitals. What do I need to do to them to make them function like a real district hospital? And so this is a fairly tangible concept. If you can get these hospitals to the point where they can do safe cesarean deliveries, manage open fractures, and do laparotomies, that by virtue of that, you are bringing the staff, stuff, systems, et cetera, to bear in that hospital such that it will function like a real district-level hospital, all right? The third key message, 33 million individuals face catastrophic expenditure paying for surgery, and another 48 million if you include the non-medical costs, so getting to the facility, the things that I talked about that aren't you know, truly paying for medical care. And A, I think this is an underestimate. I'm sure it's higher than that. We were pretty conservative. And B, you know, when you think about 81 million, I lived and worked in Australia for about 5 years, and they have a population of just over 20 million. This is four Australias. So every year, four populations of Australia face catastrophic or impoverishing expense trying to, you know, get to surgery. Now, that doesn't include the folks who give up and don't get their surgery, all right? So this is just people who have their surgical procedure. Now, shouldn't come as a surprise that that's an issue when more than 3 billion people in the world live on less than $250 a day. So, you know, if you're in rural Haiti and it's going to be $700 to have your femur fracture fixed, you can't do that if you're living on $2 a day. Key message 4, investing in surgery is affordable, saves lives, and promotes economic growth. So this, we really strengthened this argument after that Bellagio meeting that I told you about, because a number of the Ministry of Health people raised their hand and said, look, you don't understand. I need to actually walk across the hall and talk to my Ministry of Finance. I just can't magically come up with money. So you guys need to come up with economic arguments for why I should go to my Ministry of Finance and ask for more money. So we did that. And we made some estimates. We did some modeling. And we said, what would it cost to scale up the low and middle income world to provide the type of care that we've been talking about? All right, and we came up with just a fantastic number, $350 billion. And you think, wow, that is impossible. How can you possibly do that? Now, this is a 15-year number, $350 billion. All right, now put that in the context of the fact that world GDP is $70 trillion per year. All right, so this is a fraction of world GDP every year. All right. You know, the U.S. defense budget is $500 billion a year for 1 year, all right? So just to put things in context. Now we did the other side of the argument and said, well, if we were going to make that kind of an investment, would it help the economy? And we came up with another fantastic number, $12.3 trillion. So whether either of these is really correct by a factor of two in either way, it's still, you know, there's a proven economic impact on investing in healthcare. And the commission before us was called the Commission on Investing in Health, and they found similar things. And theirs wasn't specifically addressing surgery, but the bottom line is they also showed that investments in healthcare are pro-growth, all right? Now, speaking of that, I want to call your attention. Jeff Sachs, he's a famous healthcare economist. A number of you have probably heard of him. In, when was this, 2001, he came out and modeled what the effect of malaria was on developing economies. And he published this paper that said that malaria could have a 1.3% drag on developing economies. And people thought that was unacceptable. That was outrageous. All right. And so we looked at surgery. And looking between 2015 and 2030, you see that developing countries, surgery could account for upwards of 2% drag on their economies if we ignore it, if we just leave it the way it is. All right, so if that was unacceptable and spectacular for malaria, you know, this is why surgery should be part of the public health debate. And this is an incredibly important statement, and this is a statement that Jim Kim made in January of 2014 at that first meeting I told you about that was across the street. He said, surgery is an indivisible, indispensable part of healthcare. And the reason that's important is, and we were very careful in the commission and after, we're not advocating for surgery versus infectious disease or surgery versus maternal health. You have to put all that together. And it goes back to Paul's statement, you know, you can't look at healthcare vertically. It doesn't make sense to invest thousands of dollars in antiretrovirals if the patient dies of a perfed appendix the next day. All right, so you have to look at healthcare holistically. Indicators. We did exactly what Richard Horton asked us for. And the other thing I didn't tell you is actually in Jim Kim's initial address to us in 2014, he also asked for time-bound metrics for surgery. So we were getting, we're getting a call from Richard Horton and Jim Kim saying this is what you need to do. So we did that. And we came up with six. The first, 2-hour access to timely surgery. So in the maternal health world, this is that they feel like women should be within 2 hours of a facility that can perform safe C-sections, and we borrowed that from them. The second was this workforce indicator, how many surgeons, anesthesiologists, and obstetricians are there? So where are people in relationship to facilities? What is your workforce? How many surgical procedures are you doing per year? You know, if you run any company, General Motors knows how many cars it made last year. If you run any company, you ought to know what you're doing. And then perioperative mortality rate, the crudest safety measure. So again, if you're providing healthcare, you ought to have some idea of the safety and what's happening to those patients that are going through your system. And surprisingly, this has generated all sorts of arguments and people, you know, there have been people who have been vehemently opposed to this and say it's not fair and you have to risk adjust and da-da-da. And at the end of the day, I just feel like, you know, if you're sending patients through a healthcare system, you really ought to know how many people are dying. I mean, then you can drill down and do a root cause analysis and decide why they're dying. But to just say, no, I'm not going to keep track of that doesn't seem terribly logical. Two indicators related to financial risk protection. All right, and if you're an economist, these words mean something different, impoverishing versus catastrophic expense. But I think it highlights the importance of the financial risk protection. And the fact that, you know, 3 billion people live on less than $2.50 a day, and so you have to take account of this. And in fact, Mark Schreim, who's in our group, he did his PhD on issues related to financial risk protection, and showed that, you know, you have to be careful. If you scale up healthcare or surgical care, you actually can have the opposite effect. If you don't account for financial risk protection, you can impoverish people. All right, so not only will you not get those benefits that I was talking about, but you may actually impoverish people. National Surgical Plan, we came up with this. This is from the document itself. That's too much to read right now. But the important part is that we grouped it into five sensible categories. So what does the infrastructure look like in your country? Workforce, service delivery issues, financing, how's it getting paid for, and information management. How are you analyzing data? So this came out in April or May of 2015. We had a launch in April in London and then a launch here in May. I'm going to spend the rest of our time just talking to you briefly about what's happened since then. So this actually is Bellagio. So that was that fourth meeting. So as you can see, the Lancet Commission was a tough gig. And this is in February, believe it or not. So yeah, this was great. And actually, I'd love to do commissions all the time. And actually that was my room right there. And actually, it was the whole floor, so I would look out on the water. It was incredible. So I keep asking to do more commissions. We asked the people at that meeting, we said, you know, what needs to happen next? And the people in that meeting were pretty clear. They felt that there needed to be some coordination between research and advocacy and national implementation, all right? And they felt, the reason is they felt you can't just give people this book and say, there you go, off you go, you know, best good luck to you. Provide countries and health systems with the assistance they need. So a lot of discussion around the fact that it's great to come out with this book, but you've got to figure out some way to translate it from the pages to implementation. So I'm going to tell you a couple categories of things that I've seen happen since the commission. And this isn't the commission that did all these things, by the way. So we've seen a broad expansion, which is important because it's not possible to scale this movement by having 30 commissioners who they have day jobs, and there's no possible way they can do this. So you look at the indicators. So we came out with those indicators. They were nowhere to be found on the globe, so you couldn't go to the WHO or World Bank and find these indicators. And just to take a step back for a minute, why are those important? So why did Jim Kim think they were important? Why did Richard Horton think they were important? There's this famous quote, and some people think James Harrington said it, Peter Drucker, other people have been attributed with this quote, but you can't manage what you don't measure. All right, so any company, again, they're measuring all sorts of things. You know, production companies measure everything to do with production. And in surgery, we weren't measuring anything. We didn't know how many patients were coming in. We didn't know how many were coming out. We didn't know anything about our workforce. We didn't know anything. All right. So we went to the World Bank, and actually Swag mentioned that time that we were in D.C. at the World Bank. This is actually when we met with them and took the indicators and said, hey, would you please consider publishing our six indicators in this thing called the World Development Indicators. So if you Google World Development Indicators, World Bank, you'll come to a site that is amazing. And it has these sections in it. Infrastructure, health, there are probably 15 different sections. And if you look here, this is prior to 2016. You won't find surgery or anesthesia or you know, orthopedics or whatever. But amazingly, in April of 2016, they agreed to publish all six of our indicators, but we only could come up with the data for four. So getting two-hour access is actually surprisingly difficult, and getting the perioperative mortality is also surprisingly difficult. You cannot just go to a Ministry of Health and say, hey, could I have your post-operative death rate in your country? That, believe it or not, that doesn't exist, all right? But the good news is that as of April 15th, 2016, you can now go to the WDI site, and these four have data on them. All right. Now we've continued this effort, and we're hoping that in subsequent years we will have these two, and then this will need to be an ongoing process. And actually, you know, this ongoing data collection is something that med students have been very important in. You know, because they're med student relationships all over the world, and you know, I'm sure you guys also have them. So your group could actually be very helpful in continuing this process of data collection. Again, I give a lot of credit to the World Bank. So not only did they agree to publish our indicators, surgical indicators, but they've also, you know, promoted on their blogs. They've been very proactive about incorporating surgery into their data analysis. Now, single country studies. So a number of countries have said, okay, let's take that concept and let's look at what indicators look like in our country. And the reason that's important is it's one thing to have global numbers and to look at country by country, but if you're a minister of health, you need to know what the subnational variation looks like. So here's some work our group in Boston did in Brazil, and this is just one example. So on the left, we came up with the data points that you need to collect to get all six of the indicators. And on the right, this is an example of what the surgeons, anesthesiologists, and obstetricians look like in the different states in Brazil. And you won't be surprised to know that in one area, it looks much different than another. I mean, so Brasilia is like New York City, and there are other areas, there are areas in the Amazonas region that are even worse than this average of 11. So countries are not, you know, monolithic. Different parts of countries look very different, and the governor of Amazonas region has very different needs from what Brasilia needs. And that's really important because in many countries, the state ministries of health have a lot of, you know, they play a very important role in delivery of health. Some countries it's the federal ministry of health, some countries it's very much the state ministry of health. National surgical planning. So I showed that slide about national surgical planning and looking at those five different domains. And this also came out of that meeting in Bellagio. And there's a story that these guys in the front row are gonna hate this. I tell this story every time. They've probably heard it 40 times. We were in Bellagio, and we were talking about national surgical planning, just the concept. And at that point, it wasn't even necessarily going to be in the Lancet Commission. We were just kind of kicking it around at that point. And Emmanuel Mikasa, he's the Zambian rep to the WHO. And he was across the table down the room, and we went on to other topics. And 20 or 30 minutes later, we were talking about something entirely different. And Emmanuel raised his hand, didn't say anything, and I saw him across the room, and I said, Emmanuel, please speak up. And he said, I have just been texting with my government, and we would like to work with the Lancet Commission on national surgical planning. I said, wow, that's incredible. If only I could text my government. especially after the election. So we worked with Zambia, and again, this was a multi-stakeholder event. You know, the UK, THET, our program, Zambian Ministry of Health, very tightly driven by the Zambian Ministry of Health. So I think ownership of these processes in most cases is best at the Ministry of Health. And the reason I say that is that, again, not every country is the same. So in India, you can't go to the federal Ministry of Health and drive a nationwide national surgical process. In India, there are states that are more populated than the US, and those state ministries of health are very important. But in many countries, I would say in most countries, the federal Ministry of Health is extremely important. So they helped to drive this process. We provided support. And we went there and said, here's the concept for what you might do for a national surgical plan. There's going to be a planning phase. You need to do these things, identify your stakeholders, drivers, collect data, analyze the data. And then you need to have some type of a national surgical forum where you take all this data, your as-is argument for the country, and say, okay, here's where we are. Let's do this. And then obviously there's an implementation phase. And what I like about the Zambia process is they took it and changed it and made it their own. So they did some different things. They had a writing workshop. They had a costing workshop. They modified it a little bit, which was good because it actually helped us learn, and we're taking some of those things to other countries now, all right? And, you know, for example, there's SWOG, by the way, in the back. This is the writing workshop. So they got all their ministry folks together and said, okay, let's take all the data that's been collected and sit down for a week, and you guys have to write this thing. We're going to put pizza under the door, and we're not letting you out until it's done, all right? And then they had a big meeting. So they took this document and brought all the stakeholders together, and there's SWOG again. SWOG's everywhere. And they presented the document to all the stakeholders in Zambia, and then they had a costing workshop. So they brought in all the accounting folks and said, this is pretty much what we've agreed to. What might this cost? All right. So writing a forum to get all the stakeholders involved and then costing it out. And that's actually, you know, we're doing things like that in other countries because that's a good approach. And the good news is, and SWOG was almost uniformly responsible for this process. He saw this through the entire way. And you notice there is now a signed document that is part of their national health plan. This is, as far as I know, this is the first country that has a formal national surgical, obstetric, and anesthesia strategic plan that is formally embedded into their national health plan. All right? It's amazing. We did a quick scan of national health plans, and there were a couple that had the word surgery in them. But this is several orders of magnitude different from what you had found before then. Now, the thing that I didn't fully anticipate, I was thinking, great, we're going to do these national surgical plans. But we've seen this concept of regional collaboration, regional benchmarking come up that if you had talked to me 3 years ago, I would not have anticipated this. So I was in Melbourne in October of 2015. And I gave a talk on the Lancet Commission. And a couple of these folks and some of the Pacific Island surgeons who were there came up to me and said, would the Lancet Commission help us go through the indicator collection and national surgical, et cetera, national surgical planning? And at that point, I said, look, we're at our bandwidth limit. We can't take on any more countries. But you know, you have a great partner here in the Royal Australasian College of Surgeons. Why doesn't the Royal Australasian College of Surgeons work with you guys? And we'll give you all the tools that we've made. We'll collaborate in any way, but we can't physically drive this process. And so Glenn and David Waters did a spectacular job. In addition to people from all of these island nations, so October, then they came back in May of 2016, all right, and at the Brisbane Royal Australasian College meeting, all of those countries had collected data and they presented all their data together in a regional approach. They looked at every indicator. Here's indicator one. The green countries our Pacific Island countries, these yellow countries, that's some data we had from the Lancet Commission. But I was shocked. So here's indicator one. What percentage of the population is within 2 hours of a facility that can provide the bellwether procedures? Well, some of these countries have it easy because they're so small that if you're on the island, you're within 2 hours of the, you know. But then you look at over here, you know, they have a problem. And again, some of them are not lucky because some of these are archipelagos. Some of these countries are archipelagos of islands. And if you're on one island, man, you can't get to, I mean, it's 3 days to get to the other island. So, and that's important to know. And people have argued about this indicator and said, well, it's not fair because what if you're an island nation with 100 islands, you know? But it's not a matter of fairness. If I'm the Minister of Health here, I need to know that, all right? I can't stick my head in the sand. So you need to know where is my population, how close are they to a hospital? Your solution's gonna be very different than in Nauru, and you need to know that. Here's a nice example. So in Timor-Leste, they did some work and they found that three district hospitals were working properly, all right? They could do those bellwethers. And that gave 50% coverage in the country, all right? And they also found that two existing hospitals were not bellwether capable, but if they did a couple things to them and kind of got them online, so to speak, then 80% of the country would be within that two-hour time I'm talking about. And again, that's a very practical, tangible thing for a Minister of Health to know, that I have these two hospitals, they can't do X, Y, Z. Instead of building more hospitals, doing all sorts of other stuff, if I just, this one needs electricity, this one needs an anesthesiologist, done, all right? So this is why I like these indicators, because they're very tangible, and a Minister of Health can make decisions based on those indicators. Here are the rest of them. I'm not gonna bore you with all of them, but I just think it's so impressive that all these folks went back to their countries, put their heads down, and in like 6 months, they came back to Brisbane with data on their countries, all right? And we didn't do it for them. They basically did it themselves. Here's an interesting graph. It's not statistically significant, but I just think it's fascinating to look. Access is in yellow in the back, and mortality is in green in the front. And it's just funny how even in the first pass, the countries that had better access had lower mortality. Is there a relationship? I don't know. There's not enough patients in this, but this is the kind of thing that you need to do over a 10-year period as your data collection gets better to see, is this related? And you're only going to find that out over 10 years. I like the idea of regional collaborations. The other thing that Emmanuel Makasa said to me once, because people were worried that countries were going to be afraid of sharing their data, and he said, actually, it's probably a good thing because you're going to get a little bit of competition. And one country looks at its neighbor and says, wow, if we can do this around surgery, or if they can do this around surgery, why can't we? And it actually, within about 6 months, that happened. So Zambia started this process. Zimbabwe contacted Walt Johnson at the WHO and said, hey, that's not fair. Zambia's doing this process. Like, we want to do this. So they reached out to the WHO to start the same kind of thing. So in quick summary, what are the takeaways that I want you to leave with for the Lancet Commission? One is this vision, all right? Two, the five key messages. Oh, and you don't have to worry, I'm gonna publish this on Twitter, all right? So at John Mira, I'll post the talk. You can use it, there's no proprietary issues. Give the talk at your schools, you know, whatever. It's free to use. The third thing is indicators. I think it's important to know the six indicators. And then the National Surgical Plan has turned out to be more impactful than I thought it would be. And as I said, even in Bellagio, we weren't even 100% sure that it was going to be part of the commission, and now it's turned out to be a really important thing. So this is related to, this is February of 2017. This is Commissioner Mustafa Koloko, and I was just at the African Union. There was a meeting there, and he spoke at that meeting. So he's a commissioner, he's not a surgeon. He might be a physician, but I'm not even sure he's a physician. And I was shocked at what he said because, you know, it's 2017 now, literally in 2014. All right, think about BC, like before commission, what things were like. All right, I wanna show you what, this is Minister Koloko at the commission, at the African Union, saying some things that have implications for the entire African Union, and I was actually shocked that he would do this. So I wasn't sure either. Let me end by reiterating the fundamental importance of putting global surgery on the political and policy agenda of our governments. I was shocked that he said that at the African Union. I mean, that has policy implications for the countries in the AU. There is a clear investment case for surgical and anesthetic services. They save lives, can be affordable, and contribute to economic growth and the achievement of Agenda 2063. So the AU has come up with a strategic plan called 2063, and they have these goals. It's kind of like the SDGs for the AU. But for him to link surgery to the AU Agenda 2063, frankly, I thought he was going to get in trouble for saying this, you know. More importantly, surgery is an indispensable part of healthcare and should be an integral component of a national health system in countries at all levels of development. That is a striking official comment from someone who's a commissioner of the African Union. I'm glad to see it, and I think it's very forward-thinking. But you know, think about 6 years BC when Paul was at the Rwanda Surgical Society. There's not a commissioner or minister in the world who would have linked surgery with some type of continental strategic plan. You know, so we've come a long way since Paul and Jim published that famous quote that surgery is the neglected stepchild of public health. So with that, I'll stop talking, and I'd love to take any questions. And as I said, in a few minutes after this talk, I'll publish this on Twitter. And honestly, you guys can use it in any way you like. There's nothing proprietary. So thank you very much. It's good to be here. We have time for a question or two?
Time for a few questions.
Okay, all right. Any questions? Yes.
Medical students and trainees, how we can be a part of this work.
Well, so there is a precedent for that. You know, I talked about round one of data collection. We're now in round two, and Izzy Marks, who is a med student in the UK and is part of the IFMSA, she has been helping us with round two of data collection because of that network of med students all over the world. And we literally have med students that are helping with data collection in their ministries through IFMSA, all right? So, I think through your organization, you know, possibly in collaboration with the IFMSA, you will have students who are literally in the capitals near those ministries of health and have access to things that I don't have. So I would say, tangibly, how do you do it next? You know, I guess Parissa and Andrew are usually at our Thursday morning conferences over at 641. It's as easy as just kind of getting involved with our PGSSC, and we have a number of projects going on. You know, we would love to have medical students involved with global things like this or specific, research projects at a district level hospital. So there are hundreds of ways that you guys can get involved. Right. Any other questions? Yes.
So the quick turnaround between the publication of the commission and the immediate impact that it had, for example, the National Surgical Plan in Zambia, that strikes me as like the best case scenario that this kind of policy recommendation could have. Do you have any insight on what made the commission particularly persuasive in the community?
That's a great question, really important question. Zambia was successful because of two people, Emmanuel Makasa and SWOG. And I'm over-exaggerating that a little bit. In reality, SWOG gives a fantastic talk about the Zambia process, and he will tell you that it worked because of hundreds of people, and that is true. But Emmanuel Makasa took ownership of this and was someone who was in the, close enough, he was in the government, close enough to the Ministry of Health, that when SWOG would have problems, for example, you know, he would email me and I would email Emmanuel, and then magically within about 20 minutes, we'd get an email that would solve the problem. So that type of involvement at the level that will make it happen is key. You should listen to SWOG's talk on Zambia. It's exceptional because he goes through the entire process, who was involved. I was really speaking in hyperbole you know, when I said it was Emmanuel and Swag, because he will talk to you about hundreds of visits. I mean, is it safe to say you talked to thousands of people as part of this? I mean, they had so many meetings, got all the stakeholders involved. So you ask why it was successful? Because it was a total multi-stakeholder process, and no one felt left out. You know what's funny is even, I said no one felt left out, even with what these guys did, there were still small pockets within Zambia who, you know, would get their feathers ruffled at one thing or another. So you almost can't try hard enough. But the reason some of these things are successful is you got to get all the stakeholders involved and government buy-in. So I don't think it's wise to start this process unless you have high enough level buy-in in the country, because you just won't get it done. So if a ministry wants to do it, if the Minister of Health says, I am committed to this and I want it, then it has a chance of succeeding. Yes, Matt.
How in general, how are these countries paying for this? Should they shift their budget?
Good, very good question.
Because it seems like there's a critical amount of money based on GDP that is the threshold for where things really start happening.
Very good question. I'll answer that in a couple ways. So one, how do you pay for the national surgical planning process itself, first of all? And we kind of cobbled that together for Zambia. THET was involved, you know, UK Aid. We had some other people involved. You know, honestly, the Clutching Foundation has helped with a number of these things. So a number of things that the Program on Global Surgery has done would not have been possible without their support. So there was that kind of seed money that got some of these things finished. Now we're seeing industry partners get involved. So the GE Foundation is helping with a process that's going to be starting in Tanzania. All right, and so, and that's spectacular. Because the GE Foundation is involved, now you see Johnson & Johnson looking at that saying, maybe we should get involved. So I'm hoping that we'll see more and more industry support around this process. Bottom line is, it takes a couple hundred thousand dollars to finish a national surgical planning process. But then your question, probably where you were going, is how does the country, you know, sustain it?
Yeah.
And I guess there are certain countries that are going to need external support, and that's just the bottom line. And then there are certain countries that are going to have to make hard choices within their own spending. And that AU 2063, you know, part of that is the African Union has told itself that they've set certain spending goals for Africa, and many countries in Africa are below the spending goals on health that the AU 2063 or that the African Union has even called for. So I think some countries, like it or not, are just going to have to say, we have to spend X GDP, X percent of our GDP on healthcare.
Right.
We haven't been doing it, and we're going to do it. And this isn't me telling them that. I'm impressed. You know, the AU has set limits, or has set goals, not limits. They've set goals for what countries should be spending. So some countries are going to need aid immediately. Some countries might not need aid, but they need to make a commitment to spending a little bit more on.
Can you recommend like a certain percentage of firm?
That's hard.
Say, like, you need to spend 10% of your GDP.
Does anyone know what the AU, what their goal was? I can't pull it out of thin air, but they set a goal for spending, which I thought was surprisingly high. It was something like 15%, which seems awfully.
For health.
For health. For health, not for surgery. No. The problem you get into is percentage of GDP isn't good enough, because if a country's GDP per capita is $700, even if you spend 20% of GDP, you know, so it's both where is that country along the spectrum and what percentage are they spending? If you play around with numbers and look at GDP per capita and healthcare outcomes, the curve starts to break at about $1,000 to $3,000 per person. So it's a lot of money. And there are a lot of countries that say, I can't come close to spending $1,000 per person on healthcare. So that's a really complex. But I would go back, all that aside just for a moment, and say that, what's that famous, there's a famous quote from Alice in Wonderland. So Alice comes up to a fork in the road, and there's that cat up on the top of the tree. And Alice says, you know, where should I go? And the cat says, well, you know, where do you want to go? And Alice says, I don't know. And she says, well, if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. And my point is that if you don't even have a plan for surgery, you're just going to wander around in the darkness. So I think it all starts with having at least a plan. And what's come more clearly into focus now is that when you start these national plans, you need to already be thinking about transitioning to implementation. Actually, Robert and I just had a talk yesterday. Rwanda is about to embark on a national surgical plan. And we were talking about the fact that although we're just starting the plan, we already need to start thinking about how do we transition to implementation. So how do we get the Rwandan Ministry of Health to reach out to USAID, AusAid, you know, DFID, et cetera, because I'm hoping it will be more successful than Robert and I going to AusAid. You know, if the Ministry of Health says, hey, we're coming up with a plan, we're going to need X million dollars for the next 10 years, I'm hoping, or to Johnson & Johnson or GE, I'm hoping that if ministries have coherent plans and they go to funders with a real plan, that funders will say, oh, you guys have done your due diligence, all right, let's invest in that, you know? Yes?
The SAO indicators both show, you know, based upon the map they have up there, some lightly colored countries. Now, did the commission itself make a case to redistribute both talent and resources to countries that might need it? It seems like this unilateral approach to building a national surgical plan in a country that might not be able to actually fund it. Was there a case to places that might have those resources to actually make a commitment to redistributing?
So workforce from one country to another?
Capacity and also finances.
That certainly, we talked a lot about that, and the concept of brain drain always comes up, so training people in a country who then go to a high-income country to work. And that's a very important concept. I think we touched on it a little bit, but I don't think we gave it justice. The bottom line is, I would say most people would tell you that you really need to develop training programs and a culture of training within that country that makes people want to stay in that country. So forcing or coercing or getting people to go from one country to another is probably not a long-term solution. Getting people to work in rural communities, you probably need to train them in rural communities, right? So there's a lot of talk about how do you train people where they're going to live, and also how do you train what we would call mid-level providers? How do you train non-surgical folks to provide some? And that's really grabbing the third rail, and we were very careful about that. There are many countries that are vehemently opposed to that, and then there are some countries that are accepting it. So we stayed neutral and didn't say you should or shouldn't, but we did do an economic argument. And because it takes so long to train surgical folks, if you use, you know, non-fully trained surgical providers, clinical associates, clinical assistants, mid-level providers, you can actually cut your workforce scale up by a half pretty quickly, even with a one-to-one ratio of providers. So I guess to answer your question, I don't think moving workforce across national boundaries is probably going to be a long-term solution. I think countries need to look at how, countries or regions, you know, COSEX has done a fantastic job of regional training. So I'm not downplaying the importance of regional training, but COSEX trains people in countries, in district-level hospitals, non-university hospitals, with the goal of them staying there. So I'm not saying that you can't have a regional training approach, but you probably want to try to train folks where they're going to end up working.
I think that's it. Thank you so much, Dr. Lear.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you guys all for being here. So just to give you an idea of what the rest of the day is going to look like, we're now going to go into a short coffee break. We need everyone to be in their panel rooms by 10 a.m. because we have a lot that we want to squeeze in, a lot of information, great speakers. So please be there on time. You can look at your programs to know where you're going to go, but just so people are aware, on the first floor, we have Education and Capacity Building in room 106, Crisis and Humanitarian Aid in room 128, and then on the third floor, we have subspecialties in global surgery in room 306, and then innovation in global surgery in room 328. Your ticket inside your badge will say which one you are during this first panel session. So it'll say one, and then the name of the session that you're in. If you have any questions, there's also we'll be circulating around during the break. So thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
Oh.